In the last video, we did some organizing and set up the system for the FK-IK switch, complete with custom driver controls. Now we need to set up the IK systems for the arms, the legs, and the spine, all three of which I'm going to be tackling as individual videos. And when we're done with all three setups, we're going to restore the right side of the armature and move on to the final steps of the rigging process. So for the first video dealing with the IK systems, I'm going to start with the arms because I believe it's the easiest to construct. It's going to be somewhat similar to the IK system that I made in the introduction video, but it's going to have a little bit more functionality. So first off, I'm going to go into pose mode and I'm going to select the IK layer that we made last time, and I'm going to zoom in on the arm. I'm going to select the IK lower arm.L, and I'm going to go into the bone constraints panel and give it the inverse kinematic constraint. For any IK setup, we're going to need a target to actually control the movement, and we're going to need a pole to control the orientation. For the IK target, I think what would actually be the best choice here would actually be the IK hand bone. It's already a control bone, so it has no influence over the mesh, and even if the IK control bone was pulled away from the arm chain while posing, this wouldn't cause a problem. Even though the deform hand is set to copy the transforms of the hand control, it isn't allowed to detach from its parent, the upper arm, which means there's no downside for repurposing that hand IK as a target here. With that said, we're gonna have to remove the hand IK from the hierarchy of the arm chain. We don't want any inheritance errors. So I'm gonna go into edit mode and I'm gonna select the hand IK bone. I'm gonna rename it to hand target.L, and I'm gonna press Y to split it from the hierarchy. And then, of course, we need to place it somewhere, so I'm going to go into the bone settings, and we're just going to parent the IK control bone to the root bone by going over here to the parent's input field and type in root. Now that that is done, we need to set the length of the chain of influence over the constraint. I only want it to affect the lower arm and the upper arm, so I'm going to set the chain length to 2. Now that we have the IK target down and fixed the chain length, we have moderately good control over the arm, but we still need to create the IK pole. So to make that, I'm going to go into edit mode, and from the elbow, I'm going to extrude outwards towards the Y axis. Then I'm going to split the bone away and move it further away from the elbow in the Y axis. Since this is going to be the pole for the left arm, I'm going to name it polearm.L. And just like the hand control, I'm going to parent it to the root bone, and then plug in the pole bone as the pole target. Now, just like in the introductory video, when we plug the pole in as a target, the arm will more than likely rotate upwards or downwards relative to the pole, which isn't something what we want it to do. So to fix this, we're going to have to adjust the pole angle, and more often than not, if we set the angle as some increment of 90 degrees, it'll more than likely fix it. And that is going to form the basis of the arm IK setup. However, I want to add just a little bit more functionality for myself. I want to make a control attached to the arm chain that can rotate the pole about the elbow to adjust the orientation, instead of having to manually place the pole in local space, which is less intuitive. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go into edit mode and I'm going to add a new bone, but I want to place it in a very specific spot. I'm going to select this point here at the edge of the upper arm, and I'm going to select this point here at the base of the hand IK target, and I'm going to hit Shift S and move the 3D cursor here. This point is the exact middle point between the upper arm and the hand IK, which is going to become a pivot point for the arm pole, so I'm going to line up this new bone to point towards the hand target bone. And from here, if I set my transformed pivot mode to individual origins, I can scale the bone down to make it less big. I'm going to rename this bone to IKPoleRotator.L, and finally, I'm going to parent the arm pole to the pole rotator, and then I'm going to parent the pole rotator to the clavicle bone. With that done, there are two more things that we got to do. For one, I want this bone to stay as the medium point between the upper arm and the hand target, which is going to require some constraints. And the last thing we'll do is we'll set up a driver to control it with a custom property. So, the constraint for this arm rotator bone is pretty simple to implement. The first constraint we'll be using is a copy location constraint with the target set to the IK upper arm. The second constraint will also be a copy location constraint, however this time we'll set the influence to 0.5, and we're going to slide this head-tail slider to 1. And the final constraint that we're going to add is a damped tracking constraint, which is going to target the hand IK target bone. So after speeding through and setting up those three constraints, I think I should slow down a bit and explain what they are supposed to do. So for the constraints, you should know they are applied from top to bottom. So the first two constraints are designed to calculate the exact middle point between the upper arm and the wrist. That way, the pole rotator bone is always located at the elbow, making it a good pivot point. Since the copy location constraint by default replaces the location of the constrained bone, the pole rotator first copies the upper arm and snaps there. Then, the second constraint is applied, and normally it would snap to here, since the constraint would copy the base of the bone. However, since we slided the head-tail slider to 1, it'll instead copy the tip of the bone, here. And then, by setting the constraint to half influence, it only goes halfway between the upper arm and the lower arm. And the last constraint that I added, the dampened tracking constraint, what it does is it makes the pole rotator bone always point towards the hand bone, which will allow us to keep the pole in alignment as well as allow it to rotate about out the elbow in a very nice and clean way. Now we are finally down to the last thing we need to do for the arm IK. Set up the drivers to allow us to toggle the pull rotators on and off. Just in case there's an instance where I need to set a custom pull vector independent of the rotator, I'm going to make a new custom armature property called dynpull, or dynamic pull, off/on, and I'm going to copy this as a driver. I'm going to go over into the arm pull rotators constraints, and I'm going to paste it into the influences of the constraints. However, we're going to run into a problem. The property that we copied is a value between 1 and 0, as it's acting as a sort of boolean to turn the effect on and off. However, this effect is dependent upon keeping the influence of this constraint at a value of 0.5, meaning the property that we made cannot directly act as the driver for this constraint. In the last video, I had only gleaned on the ideas of what drivers are, and in this video, we're going to work on how to manipulate drivers to make them do what we want. Unfortunately, this is an easy fix that I think most people could do in about 30 seconds, barring the obvious watch time. So to do this, we're going to right-click on the influence here, and we're going to click on Edit Driver. But first, a short aside about the Editor Driver menu. It's a little finicky. It will disappear if you move your cursor away from the menu. Alternatively, instead of using the Edit Driver menu, you can open up the Edit Driver window, which pops up an entirely new window, with a graph editor and other knickknacks. I tend to not use it because I simply don't make drivers complex enough to need it. When we open up the Edit Driver menu, we're going to see a few things. We're going to see the type of driver that it is, which is currently set to Average Value, and we're going to see the property itself, with a direct path and its current value. We can actually have multiple values at once, which we are actually going to do by the time we get around the Spine IK system, but we're going to keep it simple for now. We want to set this driver type to a scripted expression, which is going to add a new input field here. This long string of text right here is the variable, our calling card for this property right here, and it is needlessly long, so I'm going to shorten it by renaming the variable here. And when I hit enter, we're going to get an error for an invalid Python expression. Obviously, what has happened is since we changed the name of the variable at the source, the variable in the expression no longer exists. So we'll just copy the variable from the source into the expression and that will fix it. And now for the expression itself. When our custom property, the driver controlling the dynamic pull effect, is quote unquote on, the value will be 1. And when this effect is on, the influence of the driver should be 0.5. So what we should do is we should take the value property and divide it by 2. And to do that, all I'm going to do is in this expression, just going to type in /2. And that should be all she wrote. We should now have a working IK arm chain with a working dynamic pull control system, which means we are at the end of the video. I'd like to thank you all for watching. If you like this video, be sure to like and subscribe. For more notifications, you can follow me on Twitter where I make announcements and post art. I also try to stream on Twitch Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 4:30 p.m. when I can. If not, you will know about it on Twitter if I make an announcement about it. I also have a Discord and subreddit where I hang out and chat about art, 3D modeling, and animation stuff. If you want to support me financially, which will help me make future tutorials, I have a Ko-fi page. I don't like to advertise my Ko-fi page because it kind of just feels like I'm begging, but I am planning to put up free downloadable content on there, so that way if you want free 3D assets, you can go and download them there. Be sure to check those links out, all of which are in the description below, and really, that's all I have to say. See ya.